officially, everybody.
Good morning.
Welcome to Timbertown. Thank you for joining us this morning. My name is Gray. Obviously, I'm the bullock here in Timbertown this morning. Folks, questions, love them. Stupid ones, silly ones, technical ones. Spin them out, they're doing my best. Who's talking over the top of me, boy? All right. So, questions, as I said, stupid, silly, technical, spin them out. Now, this is the second week of school holidays, folks. We're in a routine. Today, I'm probably going to confuse myself. But not only for my benefit, particularly for the bullies, I'm changing routine around. I know you guys aren't going to know which way I'm going, so I'm actually doing pretty much the demonstration reverse, just to keep them a little bit along, make them think a little bit. So to start with, I'm going to take the load around. I usually finish off by taking the load around, but we're going to do it first up this morning. But what we're looking for, explaining what we're working for, and what we're looking for when a bullock is working is heads down and tail up. Very politically correct, thank you, ma'am, this morning. About 5.5 tons, the hardest part for these boys to do is initiate momentum, get the load rolling. Once we're rolling, look for the bullock's heads will be down the front. The muscle on the back of the neck contracts, it's a pushing motion 100% with the back of their neck. That's the neck hole, that's what they're pushing into, that's what takes up the weight and the load. There, the bow, pretty important part of the kit, generally individually made, vital to get right, do a lot of damage if we don't. There are key holes which give us some adjustment down the side of each bow. The bow slides either side the bullock's neck, up in the yoke. Too big. This area being too big, the neck hole will go up over the muscle on the spinal cord. Good worker. Some of them are stupid enough to work in pain. You're going to damage their spine quite bad. To go as far as to say they'll cripple and drop in the yoke. We don't want that to happen pretty obviously. Too small, it's very obvious. Chokes them up, makes it hard for them to breathe. So we've got to get this right. Holding it together, we've come to one of, if not the most important part of the kit. This is the key. Piece of green hide leather through it. This is what locks and squares it away. Key goes in the keyhole. It gets very technical here with half a granny knot. Another half granny knot, the leather will bind on itself, it'll pull up nice and tightly together, and that, as I've said, is what's locked and squared them away. So basically, this team of 8 this morning fell together with 8 little bits of leather. The yoke itself is a different subject. It's part of the trade to make all the equipment for your own animals, timbers and tools. If you're interested in that, side of it, come down and say good day after demo. The start ring on the yoke is what hooks these chains that run between the pairs and turns the pairs into a bullock team. Any questions on that part? Any questions on the equipment at all? 2 to 3 miles an hour. You will never ever see a bullock team go any faster than that. It's a slow, steady, strong, stubborn pull. Now I've got young leaders up the front. They've only been leading for 18 months. They are still quite immature. Equivalent to maybe a pair of teenage boys. They know their manners, they know their commands. But after 18 months of leading, they've got to a stage where they're trying me out to see what they can and can't get away with. They're pretty casual boys. Their pace is down as well, so working on pace at the moment. Righto, fantastic. So I put them on this load. As I said, I've changed this part around. So they're sort of thinking what I'm doing this morning, I'm changing routine, particularly for them. Spur! Gee up, boys. Spur, gee up, Ranger. Come here, Dusty. Oh, boys, they're harder work for me, obviously. It's a lot, I can just go through the routine and do it easily. But yeah, for my, for their benefit. Look back. The hardest part to do is initiate the momentum, get the wheels rolling. But once we're going, heads down, bottoms up, is what we want to see. Coming up the hard bit right now when Banjo finishes doing what he's doing. Ranger! Here, boys! Yes, mate.
Do they go really fast sometimes?
Oh, they don't go much faster than that, mate. Whoop. Oh, you banjo, come here. You ever see a bullock team yoked up like this guy's running? Pretty much good advice would be to get right out of the way. You're out of control. Whoop. Albert here.
Can you tell me where you are right
now? Any more questions? Yes, mate.
How do you keep them from disobeying you?
Oh, they're not perfect, mate. But just repetition, patience, lots of TLCs, lots of hours gone into this team. Doesn't happen overnight. I just haven't got them going. Got them out of the paddock this morning, while and put them in the yoke. Months and years. Yes,
how old are the oldest ones?
Okay, we'll go through them all now. Every pair of bullocks in the team has a position. Every bullock has his own name to his own right. Trooper back. Every pair of bullocks in this team, they're all fair dick and Aussie bullock names. They've been used and passed down from bullocks to bullocks. So the most important pair, obviously, leaders. Steering, stopping, reversing, U-turns, weaving through the bush. A good pair of lead bullocks are vital. Generally only 2 or 3 out of 20 make good leaders. Brains and common sense. Work ethic, lead by example, the old saying. The most important thing a good pair of leaders have, will they listen and respond. 2 boys in the lead this morning, their names are Spur and Banjo. 6-year-olds, still quite immature. Equivalent, as I've said earlier, teenage boys. So know their manners, know their commands. We've got to a stage where they're trying me out. A bit more manners. A little bit more pace and a little bit more maturity, so they're going to be good little working bullocks and 6-year-olds. So that's Spur and Banjo, Ranger and Dusty, the old boys. These boys are 11. We're quickly coming up to 11. Dusty, you'll notice if you haven't noticed already, Dusty's got the broken horn. We've done this in the first couple of months of his training. He's only a 2-year-old. It was about the second time I worked him in the bush. It's an occupational hazard. Hasn't he got pulled up against a tree. Dusty's also coming up for his birthday pretty soon. About the 19th of October it is, he was born on the same day Slim Dusty passed away. I named him Dusty the day he was born. Ranger, I named after Shorty Ranger, another country musician from the Kempsey area and one of Slim's best mates. We're not only named after those gentlemen, as I said, they're fair dick and working bullock names. So leaders, next to lead, pin bullocks, always second from the back. Until about 5-6 months ago, these were my babies. This is Captain and Trooper. These boys are fives. 12 months younger than the leaders. Had this pair since day dot. Seen them born, loving the death, they're coming through beautifully. A little bit hard to comprehend the size of them when you're looking down them, but considering we've got 4 pure Devons up the front, another pair of pure Devons down the back, and these are the babies. They're still growing. There's a bit of crossbreeding going on. Pretty obviously, Captain is the most prominent crossbreed. He's an A1 cross, a 50-50. His father was a pure Devon, same as the other boys. His mum was a pure Hereford, hence the white face. Big, beautiful bullock. Coming through the lead beautifully, and I think, and a big call for me now, but fingers crossed when I dig in a couple of months up in the lead, they will be going better than what I've got in front at the moment, so see how we go. Trooper, this little fella here, it's hard to pick at him. He's actually got a little tiny bit of jersey, which makes him a little bit cantankerous, a little bit cheeky. We'll see how he goes on the front in the next 6 months or so. Captain's got it in spades. Trooper, not too sure at the moment. Albert Mick, these are our two tailors. It's a full-time position, specialist in their position, what you might regard to as the second most important pair of bullocks in the team after leaders, which I'm going to demonstrate before we finish here, how we can trial from both the front and the back. Nine-year-olds, only little blokes, they're a little bit different than the other boys. One, they're only small bullocks. They're born right in the middle of a drought, so nutritional value for the first couple of years of their life, they are real tough. Notice also the real curly coats on them. Notice how the horns are tipped on the pair of them, but the horns are short and fat. They pretty much look like little bulls. And the reason for that is late castration time. They weren't done until nearly 15 months old. If you're going to do them and work with them, get them done by 6 or 7 months. So Albert Mick compared to the others, more testosterone, more obviously bull features, but what's not apparent when you know them and work with them is their attitude. Now Mick might be the deadest fella. He's not the best looking boy in the team. Pound for pound, I wouldn't live without him. He's a hard little nugget, he's a good worker, and a great tailor, knows his position well. Albert, however, and you might notice this morning, Albert's sporting the Bert Newton fringe. Albert is what I regard to as the most arrogant animal I've ever worked with. You hear Albert's name 30 or 40 times a day over the name of any other bullock in the team. And pretty much keep him awake most of the time. But in the team this morning, kids, how many animals in this team this morning?
Eight.
Adults, how many animals are in this team this morning? Nine animals. I'm the dominant animal. It's a job life, guys. It's a team effort. I'm the dominant animal, but it's nine of us in the team. My job to make us work as one. Team effort it is, perfect world it's not. It's a rough game, it's a ready game. I don't have reins, I don't have physical contact to work them with, but we work bullocks on voice command. The whip is a guidance, the attention getter, not a punishment. Think of it more like my reins on a horse and carriage, not there to flog them with. Some of them could just deal with it every now and then. Get away with it in the era that we're working in now. Alright, any questions on that?
How many bullocks would you have in a large team? How many?
A bullock team can mean from a pair to 36 to 40. Bushworking teams and typical bushworking teams are 16 to 20. To make up the larger team with these boys, we put the rest in the centre. They're called body bullocks to make up the main body and span. Big, heavy, strong animals, not real bright, the bodies, just there to push in the yoke, take up load. That's your brains and control are these four positions. The lead is the next lead up the front, the pins and tails down the back. Yes, mate?
What happens if they stop walking?
Not much at all. Stop. Depends if they're supposed to be walking or not, mate. They're allowed to stop if I tell them to. What's the matter? That's the whip. That's for naughty boys in the grandstand. Any more?
Yeah.
Yes, mate?
So you do have special ways of telling them to stop and go?
Yeah, the commands I'll go through right now, darling, so that's what I'm up to right now. Yep.
How long do they live for?
In the old days, they didn't start until 4 to 5 year old, this size and age. Physically finished 12 to 13, plain and simple, walk on out. They didn't start until physical size and put them straight to work straight away. These days, pretty obviously, we can start them young. Repetition, patience and TLC. Younger 6 to 12 months, we can start them today. Today, compared to the old days, longevity, the old days 12 to 13, it's about 20. Compared to the old days, it's very obviously, one, top of the list, hard work. None of that happens in Timbertown. Food, quality, quantity, spoiled rotten. Big one though, longevity compared to the old days today, in particular the science, the technology, the vets can help look after them very well. They're overfed, they're underworked, they're spoiled, bloody rotten, everyone. Wouldn't have them in any other way either. Yes, mate?
How can you remember which one's which?
Because they're all individuals and I've had them all since babies pretty much, mate. Good question though, very good question. I get the question a lot every day. My answer, have a think about, now I get a lot of school groups, a lot of school groups we come through. I have one teacher with 30 or 40 kids. How does she know each one of those kids? And she knows them pretty damn well. And all those kids in the same uniform sitting in that grandstand, they all look the same to me. So yeah, I've only got 8 to 12 sort of look after, mate. And I said I've had them to watch them born, some of them. So I know them very well, like my kids. Coming up 14 years now. Still the apprentice and always will be the boy. Not many left now. It is regarded to now as number 4 in rare trades in the world. It's the 4th rarest trade. We have no more than about 25 teams throughout Australia that we know of. The history of the trade is pretty much disappearing. We're starting to forget about it. The masters, the fair dinkum blokes, have done it for a living. We know more than 5 or 6 alive. And what I regard to as a master's one blokes actually done it for a living. So, and all those blokes at 90, pretty much the youngest one's 89, 90 year old. So, the trade's a big trick. Starting to be forgotten. But I was privileged enough, man. I was taken out of the bush. I got to spend a couple of years with a gentleman by the name of Harold Blanche. Harold's in Bulla Dealer area. I started here in Timbertown. I got started the what the old bully club. So I get started doing, taking the bullocks around, doing all the basics done within 12 months. I got the chance to go and spend all my spare time down in Bullardino with a team of 20 and won the last of the Masters. So, yeah, I was privileged enough to do so. I'm probably one of the last to actually go out and bullock for it properly. I can't see any more commercial teams ever working again. Harold, born in 1927, he was taken out of school at 8 years old because he was the oldest boy in his family. He was put to work at 8 years old on the offside of his father's bullock team. The term offsider, that's where it comes from, on the offside team. 12-year-old Harold had a team of 12. Chasing and pulling logs out of Bullardino Mountain at 12-year-old with his own team. He also came through the changeover from crosscuts and axes. He went into chainsaws and he also obviously come through the changeover of bullocks and bulldozers. Went to bulldozers and went back to bullocks again. But they retired at 65. Got another about 25 years of bullock driving in after 65-year-old. Australian living legend. Not many people know about him. And guess what? That's the way he likes it. Thank you very much. Hard, cranky old bugger. I got the opportunity to speak with him, but we also had to tolerate each other too. Two completely different generations. So yeah, there was a few screaming matches and yelling matches, but yeah, we had to tolerate each other. A poet out in the bush. The amount of language he can put together and string words together that make complete sense. Absolute poetry. I can't explain exactly what I'm talking. You mostly know what I'm talking about. Yeah, hard old man, really hard. All right, basic commands. So we've spoken about the offside. There's a big heavy chain dragging down the back of the team. Does anybody know that old saying?
Drag the chain.
Drag the chain. Get a bullock team to move forward. The command is G up, like giddy up, but play not G up. Leave bullocks move. The command first their name. The command, the rest we just fall up as need be. This is what I usually do at the start of the demonstration. Now we're good towards the end. These boys are probably thinking it's knock-off time, so we'll see how we go. Albert, you're waiting. Smooth! Banjo, G up, boys. Ranger, get up there, Dusty. They are typically, they are very obviously lazy, lazy animals. Captain, dear, their favourite command. Don't they just love stopping? In particular with this, as you've seen, they really do love stopping with that weight behind. Okay, one of the easiest feats, the easiest to accomplish, is to get them to stop. Hardest manoeuvre now, straight through it from the easiest to the hardest manoeuvre to teach and accomplish for a bullock team. What do you think it might be?
U-turn.
This is a sneak chain. Out in the bush, we never took wheels out there. We physically put the logs out on the ground. This would be wrapped around the butt end of the log. Bullets come through, pull the chain tight, pull the log out of the bush. Now, I'm going to give them a fair distance. That's a damn good distance. I'm going to get back to that. The reason why we practice this, I've come up, so there's my log laying out that way. It's got the sneak chain ready to hook on and pull out. We brought the team up, we've turned them up around here. I've got them firing, pointing straight home. So we can pull the log straight out. We've gone wool to hook on. Missed it by that distance. A huge job to bring 20 odd back through the bush just for that. A lot easier if you can back them into it. Now, would anybody know the command to get a bullock team to go backwards?
Back up.
Back up. At least go to go. What about the twain old wool back? No smarty pants this morning with bib, bib,